Good morning. Watering your greens for the New England Missionary Baptist Church located at 1707 County Road 48, Franklin Community, Tuskegee, Alabama.
Amen.
Wish you all a great day. You can reach us at 334-399-0905.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
If you would turn with me now to the book of John.
All right. All right.
Chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. John chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. John chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem.
All right.
Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda.
All right.
Having five porches.
All right.
In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water.
All right.
For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had.
All right.
And a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years.
That's correct.
Now when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, wilt thou be made whole?
All right.
The impotent man answered him, sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another steppeth down and before me. Jesus said unto him, rise, take up thy bed and walk.
Yes.
And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath.
All right.
And all the
Amen.
Saved.
Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Our proposition is to prove to you this morning that man is helpless without Jesus.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah.
And that when Amen. Jesus shows up, miracles happen.
Yes. All right.
Amen.
Now, therefore, we want to talk to you about a visit to the house of mercy.
All right.
All right.
A visit to the house of mercy. Mm-hmm. Now, the Gospel of John takes us back farther than the swinging gate of the Garden of Eden. Huh. And he sets us down in that time before time.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
John's gospel does not open with the manger scene of Bethlehem, nor does he speak of shepherds leaving their flocks unattended, or wise men leaving their oriental domiciles. But John focuses his evangelical telescope on the prelude of time. He opens his book by saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that he brushes away the imagination of all the vain seekers by saying to us that all things was made, that was made by this Word.
All right, all right.
And that without him, not anything made was made. Mm-hmm. Now, John goes on in chapter 1, verse 14 to say that this Word was made flesh and dwelt among us.
All right.
Yes, sir.
And we beheld his glory.
Oh, yes.
As of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And then John follows this Word made flesh into many of the miracles. and discourses that the other gospel writers overlooked.
All right. All
and
right.
out of the quartet of gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it is John that takes a solo leading position as Matthew, Mark, and Luke provide a harmonious, melodic background.
All right, all right.
Now, what you read in Matthew, you might very well find in Mark.
That's right.
And what you read in Matthew and Mark, you might very well find in Luke.
Say it.
But
yeah.
John is quite different. He writes about those things that Matthew, Mark, and Luke did not write about. And John wants us to understand that the Word made flesh is a personal Savior.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
And so he spends detailed time in presenting to us a Christ that cares about everything that we care about.
Yes. All right. All right.
And he spends special time introducing to us a Savior that is personal. And if anyone want to know Christ in a very close and intimate way, I strongly suggest consider the Gospel of John.
All right.
Now, in passage after passage, he lifts some exciting episode from the life of the master teacher. It is only John in the New Testament that tells us in chapter 2 that Jesus went to a wedding at Cana of Galilee.
Uh-huh.
And there he turned water into wine.
Okay.
It is only John who in chapter 3 tells us that Jesus stood on the housetop with Nicodemus.
Yeah.
And Nicodemus enrolled in the night school program of the master teacher.
Yeah.
And Jesus told him he must be born again. It is only John who in chapter 4 said that Jesus had an interview with a scarlet-letter woman from the village of Sychar. And as he sat atop Jacob's well, and there he gave her water that was not from the well. Only John, in chapter 6 says that after Jesus fed the 5,000, that they wanted to elect him as the bread king. But Jesus said to them, if you would please me, eat my flesh and drink my blood. And the Bible says from that time, many of them just walked away. And it traveled with him no more. And he asked the 12 disciples, will ye also go away?
All right. All
and
right.
then Simon Peter.
Yes, Lord.
He responded by saying, to whom shall we go?
All right.
Thou hast the words of eternal life.
All right.
Only John in chapter 7 says that on the last day of the feast that Jesus stood up and said, I am living water. And whosoever believeth on me,
yes,
as the scriptures have said, out of his belly shall roll rivers of water.
Yes,
now only John in chapter 8 says that they dragged a young woman to the feet of Jesus and accused her of adultery.
Yes,
and said to Jesus, Moses the law commanded us that she ought to be stoned.
All right.
What do you say? And John says that Jesus stooping and he writing on the ground reminded them of their sins and lost the benediction.
Amen.
And that they all started to walk away from the eldest to the youngest.
Yeah.
I don't know about y'all. Have you ever wondered what Jesus was writing?
Yes.
Have you ever wondered what Jesus was writing? Whatever it was, it must have been tough.
All right.
But they just turned around. Before you accuse somebody of something, you better have your hands better be clean themselves. And so it is John that gives us a very personal look at the Savior. And John says, I have written these things in order that you might believe. Now you'll find that belief or faith is the key words in John.
Yes.
And he used the words belief, and believeth more than 98 times in the Greek text of his 21 gospel book. He really wants us to understand that the Savior is a man of miracles. Matthew, Mark, and Luke stresses the compassion of the miracles. John stresses the fact that the miracles are manifestations of power and glory.
Amen.
And John gives 7 of the untold miracles of the master, he lifts them up in order that we may get an up close view at the idea that whatever you need, Jesus has it.
Amen.
Now, whether you need it to supply your needs, like when he turned water into wine.
Yes, Lord.
Whether you need salvation, like he brought to the woman at the well.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Or whether you need healing of the eyes, the legs, or the soul, Jesus got it.
Yes.
Well, John spends a lot of time acquainting us with the fact that God is a God of miracles.
Yes, Lord.
Yeah. And I don't know about you. I meet some people who don't believe in miracles.
Yes, Lord.
Now, I don't know about you, but I still believe in miracles.
Yeah.
I really do. I believe that no matter what happens, God will work miracles.
Right.
And when you study the Bible, you will find out that when a miracle has taken place in the New Testament, there is always a partnership involved. Whenever you see a miracle in the Bible, it is always something that God does and something that you have to do. There are some folk that think that God is going to do some things and do everything. But God will not do everything. There are some things you have to do for yourself.
Amen. Amen.
If you want a miracle in your life, if you don't have to, you don't have to just depend on God to do it all.
All right.
God is depending on you to do something. So you see, when you really look at it.
Say it, preacher.
Miracles happen.
Yes, it does.
As a result of a partnership.
Yeah.
Like when the rich young ruler, he walked away from Jesus, and Peter said, "Who then can be saved?"
All right.
Jesus told Peter, "With God, all things are possible."
Yes, it is.
And he used the word for with. The Greek word for with is pohafo. Which means in the company of God.
Yes, Lord.
All things. Other words, whenever man and God get together, the impossible always become possible. So you don't have to worry or beg God to work a miracle in your life.
Yeah,
Lord. Well, you just bring your will in line with his will.
His will.
And when your line will get in line with his will, miracles will happen automatically.
Yes, we. Yes, we.
There's always something that you got to do.
Uh-huh.
If you want the windows of heaven open, there is something you got to do. If you want God to bless your life richly, there is always something you have to do. But check this out.
Amen.
Miracles are signs of something that is forthcoming.
Yes, it is.
Whenever you see a sign on the road, let's say you are going to Montgomery. It's about what? 25, 30 miles? Now, you don't go by that next to that sign that says Montgomery 30 miles and just stand there.
That's right.
That sign is an indicator of what's on the way.
That's right.
And miracles in the New Testament are signs. They are the manifestation on a lower platform of what God can do for us on a higher spiritual plateau.
Amen.
When you see miracles in the Bible, if you see Jesus open the eyes of the blind, it is only to suggest that he can open the eyes of the physically blind.
Yeah.
But it is moreover a sign that he can open the eyes also of the spiritually blind.
Yeah.
And all to have spiritual sight is better than physical sight. Because if you've got good spiritual sight, you can see stuff that people with 20/20 vision never will see.
Amen.
When you see Jesus.
Yeah.
Come on now.
You see him giving legs to the lame. It is also to suggest that he can heal our lame heart.
Yes,
he
can.
And our lame brain.
Uh-huh.
And our lame thinking.
Yeah.
He is a man of miracles.
Yes,
he's a man. He's a man. And any time you let anybody rob you of the idea that God cannot work miracles, you might as well go home and sit down, because you would be not here today if it was not for miracles.
Amen. Say it, preacher.
I don't know about y'all.
But
some of us have been in places we didn't know how we were going to get out.
That's right.
Woo.
Come on, brother.
But we got out.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Yes, we can.
And some of us have been so deep in the world of life and so low at the bottom of the totem pole, we didn't think we would make it.
All right, all right. All right.
And you see us here today.
Yes, Lord.
It's a miracle that in spite of what some people say, God is still working miracles. And as you read through the book of John, you will find a fellow there that was afflicted with a sickness. And we don't know what he was sick of, but he was sick for almost 40 years. Mm-hmm. 38 years to be exact.
Uh-huh.
The Bible says that he was afflicted with this ailment.
Uh-huh.
Not only him, but the Bible says a multitude.
Yes,
And you, the multitude denotes at least 5,000 people.
Uh-huh.
And it had congregated waiting for a miracle to happen at a place called Bethesda.
Yeah, Lord.
Which interpretation from the Hebrew means the house of mercy.
All right.
John says, while the master was at Jerusalem, he paid a visit to the house of mercy.
Yes, it is.
Isn't that so?
Yes, sir. Come on now.
That the man of mercy drops in at the house
of mercy.
Isn't that marvelous? That the one that specializes in mercy pays a visit to the house of mercy. And maybe that's why it was so many folks feel sick, because although this was the house of mercy, now watch this, the man of mercy was absent.
Go ahead, preacher.
Yes, Lord.
Because it doesn't matter where you meet. If Jesus don't show up, miracles will not take place.
Amen.
And maybe that's why we see a miracle here, because the master, I wish y'all knew what I was talking about, because the master of mercy dropped in at the house of mercy. I like that, because I was a little disturbed at these people, because in a real sense, they represent you and I. Look how John described him: blind. A lot of us are blind. Halt. Withered. Waiting for the movement of the water. And John seems to raise the idea that this impotent crowd was there because the power of God was not there.
Amen.
Now, when the power showed up,
uh-huh.
a miracle happened. They represent us, friends. They represent us. We too are waiting. But just like them, most of us are waiting by the wrong food.
All right.
Now, the Greek word for food is kalumbithron, which means, which comes from the word columban, which means to dive.
All right.
We got our hopes by the wrong source.
Yes, Lord.
We're looking for the wrong thing to bring us what we really, really need.
Amen.
And a lot of us are waiting, but we are waiting by the wrong pool.
Amen.
Some of us are waiting by the pool of economics.
All right.
You let Powerball get to be $400 million.
Everybody run the joke.
All right. I'm gonna give me at least one.
That's right.
We think money solves everything.
All right.
Oh Lord, if I just had enough money, I would be happy. But if money made people happy, millionaires would not commit suicide.
Amen.
And then there are people fickle enough to believe that person-to-person relationships solves everything, but that's not why they go from one relationship after one relationship back to back, because they think they need a man or they need a woman to make them somebody.
Amen.
But if somebody else got to make you somebody, you are
nobody. Amen.
You're waiting by the wrong pool.
All right. Go ahead.
Yeah, people waiting, but they're waiting by the wrong pool.
Yes.
And these people will just wait. Well, bless my soul. One day, the man of mercy visited the house of mercy. Now, when he came there, he found this guy that had been sick 38 years. But I cannot understand. I cannot communicate to you. I never can explain why is it that out of hundreds, maybe thousands of people, Jesus went up to only one person.
Come on.
See, I want you to know Jesus can find you.
Yes. Oh, yes, sir.
Amen, amen.
You know, I just told you a multitude mean 5,000 folk.
Uh-huh.
And this man, number one, you got to remember, he laying down on something.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus walked right up to him.
Amen.
So you can hide from me.
But you can't come on.
But you can't
hide
from Jesus.
Amen.
I don't care what you can put on. He's not like Superman.
Uh-huh.
See, Superman, they say can't see through steel.
Uh-huh.
God made the steel.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Let me go. Let me go. Jesus went to only one man. Now I don't know. It has baffled me. I've looked at it. I've considered. I thought I really can't tell you what it is that we pray for some people and they get well,
uh-huh.
and they pray for others and they
get
worse.
Uh-huh.
I really can't. I really don't understand why is it we lay hands on some and they improve, and we lay hands on some and they pass away. The only thing I can think of, there was a passage in the Corinthians where Paul talks about a thorn in his side. He says he had a sickness. You do remember Paul.
Yeah.
Now, by Paul's hand, others were healed.
Yes,
for he himself was a sickly man.
All right.
And Paul said, I prayed about my condition 3 times.
Yeah.
Woo, yes.
And every time God told me no. And finally Paul said, God told me, I am not going to heal you because my grace is sufficient.
All right. Yes,
in other words, Paul, you got to learn some more about me.
Why, yes.
Not only do you need to know that I'm a healer, you need to know that I'm a keeper.
Yes.
Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about. There are many people that have reached a higher level of faith through their sickness. If it was not for their sickness, they would not pray the way they pray.
Yeah.
They wouldn't preach the way they preach. They wouldn't sing like they sing. They wouldn't testify like they testify. And if God took that thorn out of their flesh, they just might stop singing.
Come on.
Oh, you don't hear me. There are some that would take the gift and turn their back on the giver.
All right.
See, once God blesses some of us, our head gets as thick as this building.
Yeah.
And can't get along with anyone.
All right.
Now we start speaking to one another.
Yeah.
And even stop speaking to God. So sometimes he uses our sickness to our advantage. And here this cat is. 38 years. Picture it. You see him lying there. A pitiful soul. He's pitiful. Can you imagine the stress?
Yes, Lord.
Can you imagine the discouragement of lying by a pool day after day after day after day? Can you see him after 38 years? He's probably almost just given up.
Uh-huh.
Jesus walks up to him.
Yeah.
Now that is when Jesus shows up.
Uh-huh.
When you've done all you know how.
Uh-huh.
When you tried all you know.
Uh-huh.
And when you pray all you know how. And you trust
in
all you know, Jesus will show up.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's only after you have given up that he steps up.
Oh.
Somebody says man's extremity is God's opportunity.
Yeah.
Sometimes he lets you get all the way to the bottom before he pulls you back up.
Yeah.
Well, there he is.
Yes, sir.
Jesus comes up and he asks this man a strange question. He says, hey, would thou be made whole?
All right.
We just read that. Hey, do you want to get well? Now, isn't that strange to ask a sick person if they want to get well?
Amen.
I mean, the guy is at the place where healing happens. Anybody can see that he was there trying to get healed. I mean, would you just walk into a hospital and there's somebody just laying up there with all these beaten stuff, tubes everywhere, stuff all in their arms? And would you just say, hey, you want to get well? It just don't sound logical.
All right, all right.
Wilt thou be made whole?
Yes, Lord.
But here is the point. It is that first word, wilt. You see, being made whole wasn't the problem. Jesus can make you whole.
Yes.
The problem is, do you want to be whole?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes,
sir.
Because you see, you can only rise as high in life as your wants will carry you. If you don't want to go up, you won't go up.
Amen.
Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about. You got to have the right attitude. You got to have the right frame of mind. The only way to go up, you got to have a will to go up.
Yeah.
Now, I'll tell you what Jesus did. He gave the man a short psychiatric evaluation.
Uh-huh.
Because Jesus is saying, fellow, I see your physical condition. You're lame. I know your emotional condition. You're discouraged. I got to know, what are you thinking? Huh? So you see, you can be down so long.
Yes, yes, Lord.
Until you forget about getting up.
Amen.
Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about. Well, my sisters and brothers, I can hear some folks singing, I've been down so long.
Yeah, yeah.
Down. Don't worry me.
Yes, Lord.
Now, y'all hear somebody
say that. Go ahead.
Some folks talk about how glad they ought to be poor.
Uh-huh.
Because they say riches will make you turn your back on God.
All right.
Some folk are glad to be miserable. They are glad to be heading. But before God does anything for you, he got to think, check out your thinking.
Yes, Lord.
Huh? As a Christian, you can rise as high in this world as you want to go.
Yeah.
And God don't care how much money you make. God don't care how much fame you got.
Come on.
Right.
God
come on
blesses
now.
You.
Yes, he does.
Dial your own sign. You promote yourself. You let God raise you according to your worth. He doesn't care how high you go.
Yeah.
You won't go any higher than you want to go.
Yeah.
God won't hold you back. Huh? But you can hold yourself back.
Yes.
I talk to some of these black folk. Now they can brag about what they don't have. And brag about how great they are. And brag about how broke they are.
Yes, Lord.
And brag about how poor they are. Brag about how they live from one day at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And God will never do any more for you than you're willing to do for yourself.
Amen.
Amen.
Huh? What's in your will? What's in your thinking, man? Well, what's in your mind? Well, what you've got in your mind? Because that not only must be believed, it must be confessed before the Bible, because the Bible says life and death are in the power of the tongue.
Uh-huh.
And if you talk down, your life will be down. Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about.
Uh-huh.
If you complain all the time about your aches and your pains, you will always have what? Aches and pains.
Yes.
And if you talk about being low and poor, you will always be low and poor.
Yes.
I'm going to act like I've got something even if I don't have a thing.
Amen.
I'm going to talk like I got some money even if I don't have a dime.
All right. Come on,
somebody. Oh, my wife got all of it. Wilt thou? You know what the brother did? He started telling Jesus why he was still sick. Jesus didn't ask him that. Yeah, I want to be, you know, Jesus is a stranger. Yeah, stranger, I want to be made whole. But I ain't got nobody, huh, to help me in the pool. Now, don't that sound like some of us? You're always talking about what you don't have, who they don't have, and if they just had some help. Don't that sound like some people you know? Put his life in the hand of some people that didn't even exist. And then look at it. Talking about every time I go, somebody else stepping down before me. I bet most of those times has been very discouraging. Because I know how it is to want something real bad.
Yes, Lord.
And look across the street and somebody over there got it.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the time they don't appreciate it. Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
There are some women and men, all they want is a good man or a good woman. Just a good husband, a man that brings his check home and treats respect and treat her right. And but there's a girl across the street.
Yes.
That got one that do all of that.
Uh-huh.
She don't care whether that book leaves or dies.
All right.
I know how it is to want and others got it.
Uh-huh.
How did you just see him when the water is troubled? You just see him just trying to slide and scoop and make his way to the edge so he can just drop into the water.
Uh-huh.
Huh? About time he gets to the edge, he looks over there. And somebody done beat him. I bet he got in that pool sometime. And thought he was going to get well and looked over there, and just for a split second before he got in, another one got in, and he looked at the top of the water, and another guy over there was just shouting and splashing.
Yeah, no.
I bet he went to sleep some of those times, and when he woke up, the water was just bubbling. You know what Jesus told him, sir? That's not a problem. Take up your bed and walk. I got the first part of that. Rise. I could preach on that all day long.
Yes, Lord.
But I know you won't wait on me. Rise in your thinking. Rise in your attitude. I got that. The part I couldn't get was take up your bed. Huh? I mean, why tell a man? I mean, look, let's be honest. If you've been sick for 38 years, lying on one bed, if you ever get up, the last bed you want to see is that bed. I mean, that bothered my thinking. Why did you tell the man to take up his bed? And the Holy Ghost said, I told him, take up his bed, number one, because moving his bed from that spot was a symbol that there was no chance for a relapse.
Uh-huh.
Huh? You know there had been some of us, and that stranger came along talking about getting up and walking, you would have got up and said, well, I'm going to try this. But I'm going to leave my bed here. And if this don't work, I'll be back this evening.
Yeah.
But when the Lord does something for you, you're not going back. Now move your bed. Ain't no going back. Now when God heals you, you're healed. When God saves you, you're saved. When God blesses you, you're blessed. There is no going back. I'm talking about leaving. Talking about leaving a little cushion for Mr. Hard Time. If God ever brings you up, he can keep you up. Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about. He wants you to move your bed to show that God has brought you out. And now I got a new address. Huh? Can't you see I'm a new man? Can't you see I got a brand new name? One day I'll live in a new land. I got a brand new life. I got a new attitude. I don't walk like I used to walk. I don't talk like I used to talk. I don't walk like I move your bed. That ain't all. The Holy Ghost said, I told him to move his bed because his bed was his testimony.
Yes.
Huh? You see, when Jesus met him, the man was on the bed.
Yeah.
When Jesus left him, the bed was on the man.
All right.
Can't you see that man going down the streets of Jerusalem with a bed on his shoulders? Somebody stopped him and said, hey, what you doing with the bed on your back? And that's his chance to tell them what Jesus did for him. That's right. Hey, mister. Don't I know you? Didn't you used to hang out down around Bethesda's pool?
All right.
I'm the same man. But what you doing with that bed on your back? Sit down, brother. I got a story to tell. I used to be on this bed day after day after day, month after month, week after week. I was on this bed. Well, what happened to you, mister? I tell you, one day, a man named Jesus.
Yeah.
I don't know about you.
Yes.
I'm through many dangers, toils, and snares. That was yesterday. I'm glad today I got a testimony. I was just like this cat. I was down. I was out. I was lonesome. But one day, a man named Jesus came by where I was. I was just like him. I didn't have no friend on my side. Nobody to go my bond. But one day, one hallelujah day, a man named Jesus, I was just like him. I was crippled up in sin. I was crippled down in hatred. I was crippled up in confusion. But one day, shake somebody's hand and tell them one day.
One day.
I tell them on the other side, one day, a man named Jesus came by where I was when my life was in confusion or when my burden was heavy. It was one day when I had almost given up, when I had almost given out. A man named Jesus came by where I was, and when he came by, he worked miracles in my life. You know, Jesus never meets a man and leaves him the same way. You don't hear me, but whenever the Lord meets somebody, he always changes something. And no matter what you are dealing with today, if you give it to the Lord, he can change it right now. No matter how long you have dealt with your problem today, no matter how long you have dealt with your problem, my God is a problem solver. If you are real today, turn your life into his hands. He will work it out. You know he will. Yes, you know when I thought about it. When I considered it. Well, when I examined it and I looked at the situation, I found out that something was still missing. You see, if you haven't walked in 38 years, your feet get a little tender. If you haven't walked in 38 years, when you step on rocks, it's got to hurt. Now, you know, and then not only that, but if you haven't walked in over 38 years, your knees got to be a little
bit.
Oh, Lord, you know, when I looked at that man, he just kept on walking. He had to walk on the sharp rocks of criticism. But he kept on walking. His knees got weak, but he kept on walking. That's what I want to tell you today. When your burdens get heavy, when the Lord has brought you out, just keep on walking. Oh, you don't hear me. Although you might get a little weak and you fall down, just keep on walking. You know, you can tell the Lord, walk with me. Lord, walk with me. Now, while I'm on this teacher's journey, Lord, walk with me. You also tell him, just a closer. Walk with thee. I'm granted, Jesus, if you please, daily, I'm walking close to thee. Lord, walk with me. I don't know about you, but I'm going to walk with him every day. Jesus, Mary's baby, Jesus. Jesus came down to 40 in two generations. Jesus, my way out of no way. Jesus, my morning rise.